Good afternoon, everybody. I would like to sincerely thank Hoover Clinical Society for giving me this opportunity to talk to you all about this important topic, and especially to Dr. Uddan, and he's we know that he's working very hard to uplift the academic standards of the doctors here in the province, as well as his immense service to the kidney patients in our province. So my topic is oral cancer. As you all, I know the majority of the audience here are medical officers, so that you may be not that much encountering this oral cancer patients, except for the oncology medical officers and ourselves, as well as oncology people. So I think it is, since you all are not that much encountering the burden of this disease, I think you don't have that much of a good idea the extent of the disease, about the extent of the disease. So I'm going to give you a brief superficial introduction about this disease, and just to make you aware about the gravity of it. Oral malignancies could be various types, like oral squamous cell carcinoma, lymphomas, osteosarcomas, sarcomas, etc. But the 95% of these malignancies are oral squamous cell carcinomas, which includes lips, tongue, lobe, mouth, heart, soft, sinuses, oropharynx, cheek, gingiva, and jaw bones. This picture shows a advanced cancer, which was referred to us from one of the general surgery wards here. And if we take the global scenario of the all cancers, we can see that in our part of the world is in a better position. If we take 100,000 people, it is the number of cancer cases per year, incidence per year, is about less than 112. But in case of oral cancer, it is not so. Oral cancer is a highly prevalent cancer in our part of the world, as well as Canada, China, Russia, and Australia, as you can see. So in Asian situation, what is the situation in Asia? If we look at this map, we can see that we are in the top three countries. After Pakistan, and India, we have the highest number of oral cancer cases. So the Sri Lankan scenario, this is the data from Cancer Control, National Cancer Control Program. So it shows there's a rising trend in number of cases. And in 2019, we have found there were 2,700 cases, and the male to female ratio is 4:1. So oral cancer, as you I think already know, it is the number one cancer among Sri Lankan males, and it's the sixth common cancer among females. And the incidence, the number of cases that we are finding for new cases, are gradually increasing. There are about 3 to 4 deaths per day due to oral cancer. And I don't know what's the reason, but as we think, it is the lack of education and awareness which has caused people to come to us in a later stages. So that what national data says is more than 60% are in later stages at the presentation. But in our case, what we experience is it is more than in Hoover. We experience it's more than 75% are in advanced stages, later stages. So the 5-year survival rate, which goes drastically down, which means the 5-year survival rate is less than 20 in advanced disease, whereas in early stages, it is somewhere close to 80%. The mean survival rate, 5-year survival rate for oral cancer is about 50%. This that shows the importance of identifying the oral cancer lesions early, because the the survival rate goes down drastically, and the, it, this was the economic burden of the oral cancer. And for a stage one oral cancer patient, the government is spending, or the health system is spending about 59,000 rupees per month, and the household expenditure was like 77,000. At the later stages, this in advanced disease, the expenditure for the patient is more than 300,000 rupees, and household cost is like 71,000. So it has a big economic burden. The tobacco related cancers, it cost about US dollars, it was calculated like that, but this is Sri Lankan study, 121 million US dollars was spent on this tobacco related cancers. So diagnosis, you all know how to diagnose cancers. It's the histopathological report that is most important, and what we are doing is seeing the local extent and the regional spread, the neck mets and the distant metastasis, if any. But it is a bit rare for oral cancers to get distant metastasis. I'm showing these two pictures which I encountered when I was working in MLEPT here. So at the first class, you will see that these two are having cancers, but they are not having cancers. The lady who's having a lesion on the tongue is having granular cell tumor, which is a benign lesion. And this gent who's having a leishmaniasis, which also looks like a cancerous lesion. So it is mandatory to have a histopathological report before revealing or making the bad news to the patient before telling him or her that you are having a cancer. So these are pictures of some of the advanced cancers like stage 3 and 4 cancers. For all these cancers, the mainstay of treatment is surgery. For the oral cancer, it's surgery. But radiotherapy and chemotherapy are going to help in a neoadjuvancy or post-surgical management. But for advanced early cancers, what we are always going in a single modeling treatment, we either do surgery or radiotherapy. And for advanced cancers, we have to go for multimodality approach. Usually, it is if it is big, then we give radiotherapy or chemotherapy to shrink it, and do surgical excision and go for post-op radiotherapy or chemotherapy for both. So what are the associated problems? If you will have encountered the extraction of a tooth in one of your jaws, upper or lower jaw, you must know how many difficult situations or uncomfortable situation you all will be facing. But taking a part of the jaw out, how much misery a patient will be facing, along with these associated problems with eating, drinking, swallowing, speech, breathing, disfigurement, they are having depression. So oral cancer, it has a high morbidity and mortality, as we have seen, because if you get a patient gets oral cancer, within 2-3 years, the patient is going to die. And other problematic case is that they are presented in later stages, and we can't do much when they are presented later. And as we all know, oral cavity and face is a real visible area, but still people live with these big lesions. Why is that? Because the ignorance or lack of awareness, or are we not caring that much about those lesions as a society or as healthcare workers, or people who are in preventive side, are they not paying enough attention for these patients? Because it's not like the breast cancer, which is not visible, or we have to palpate and see. But this is clearly visible. These big lesions are clearly visible, but still patients are living with those big lesions in villages without coming for any treatment. So another thing is there's no identifiable genetic predisposition for this oral cancers, like in breast cancers. And it is mainly caused by beetle chewing in our part of the world, especially our country, India and Pakistan. So these factors shows us that it's a preventable disease. And there's a new trend in early it was older people who are getting oral cancers, but now younger people. People who are in their early 20s, 30s are getting oral cancers. One positive factor is some Arikanut products that they are using. I have encountered several patients in the Velimadu area who are chewing Babul. Babul is an Arikanut product that is coming from Pakistan. And if you start chewing Babul, within 2 years, you are going to get oral cancer, along with oral submucous fibrosis. So, etiology, it is tobacco smoking and alcohol, mainly the western part of the world. They are getting tongue cancers and throat cancers, but it is a smokeless tobacco in our part of the world. Other contributory factors are less significant in our country. The message, one important message is this oral cancer is preventable. Another thing is, if we detect early, we can cure them. So what is the way forward that we have from here? We can educate the community. Educating the community is a very important thing because we can tell them about these bad habits and help them in stopping and screening programs. We can conduct state sector and in villages to pick up early lesions and detecting early oral potential malignant conditions. That are the conditions that may arise or that may give rise to cancer. And early cancers will be very much helpful in saving these patients. OPMD, I think for the medical officers, it is very important to have good sound knowledge about these four potentially malignant diseases, which will ultimately become squamous cell carcinomas. I'll be going through some of the lesions, some common lesions, so that when you are seeing a patient, you will be able to identify if there's any and make necessary treatment. So OPMD is a lesion or a condition which occurs in oral cavity that will, at the time of diagnosis or later stage, will give rise to a cancer. The common OPMD is leukoplakia, erythroplakia. Leukoplakia is a white patch. Leo, you know, it's white. Right? Erythroplakia is a red patch. Erythroleukoplakia is a mixed one. PVL means proliferative verrucous leukoplakia. OSMF is oral submucous fibrosis that comes with Arikanut chewing. And palatal lesions of reverse smokers, we are seeing it in state working females and in soldiers earlier days because they put the lid part of the cigarette or the cigar into the mouth and smoke. Oral lichen pears, which is a mucocutaneous condition. Others are not that much common. So, chronic hypoplastic candidiasis is a form of candidiasis that occurs in the oral cavity which transforms into cancer. Leukoplakia, it is a predominant white patch of plaque that can't be rubbed off. We know that candida, oral thrush, when we rub it off, it goes off, leaving a bleeding bed. But here, we can't rub it off. It is a white plaque-like patch that occurs in oral cavity. And erythroplakia is a red patch. For no reason. Erythrolytic anemia is white and red patch, a mixed white and red patch. Proliferative varicose leukoplakia. This is one of the lesions that has a very high tendency to transform into oral cancer. About 96% of these PVL, proliferative varicose leukoplakia lesions, transform into oral cancer. And submucous fibrosis. This is mainly due to alkaloids that are in ergot. People who chew betel with ergot and people who are having this barbule-like substance, they are going to get this disease. What happens here is, first you encounter the burning sensation in mouth, so you can't take spicy food, and the mucosa becomes pale because underneath the mucosa there's a fibrous band formation, and it will gradually reduce the mouth open. And they will get angular pilitis. When the oral mucosa gets seasoned with this oral submucous fibrosis, like you are preparing the soil for plantation, anytime this will give rise to oral cancer, which is most of the time unseen, because by that time patient can't open the mouth. So they are presenting at a later stage to us, and reduced tongue movements, because this affects the tongue also, and they are nutritionally very depleted also. Lichen planus. There are about 6-7 types of lichen planus. It is a mucocutaneous condition that also occurs in the skin also, and oral lesions are preceding usually, and it also has a tendency to become oral cancer, which comes mostly in the buccal mucosa with a reddish area with whitish striations. Chronic hypoplastic candidiasis. It is the white patch, adherent patch that usually occurs in commissural region of the buccal mucosa as well as on the dorsal surface of tongue. There are some determinants that increase the malignant potential who are having these OPHDs, like advanced age, where the more aged you are more prone to get cancer out from OPHDs, female sex. And those who are not fitting the risk factors, we can understand that. And leukoplakias, white patches that are more than 200 square millimeters, that is 2 by 1 millimeter, centimeter once. And the grade of dysplasia, if we biopsy, if the dysplasia is severe, you know, mild, moderate, severe dysplasia, that is transformation into the transformation dysplastic nature according to the bearing. So the more the dysplastic features are, they are more prone to get become oral cancers. So what you all can do for this? When patients comes to you, what I think you all can do is counseling, educating. You all are asking about this risk factors, isn't it? I mean, smoking, alcohol consumption, and betel chewing. You all ask when you're taking this, you all ask, right? So that you can counsel those patients about this bad habits with regard to oral cancer, right? And systemic oral examination. You know what are the parts to see in the oral examination. You all are doing general examination, head and neck examination. When you are doing head and neck examination, you can have a look into the mouth. Most of the dental surgeons do, because they are working in the oral cancer. But you all are concentrating on mostly on other parts of the body. But if you can pay a little bit of a quick attention to oral cavity, and because other thing is that you all are getting the number of patients that are coming to medical officers is very much high compared to dental surgeons. So if you can pay a little bit of attention to the oral cavity and detect any OPMD or any early lesion, And you can go for a refer. You can refer to either in here, onco surgery unit, oncology to us. Okay. And keep a track on whether they are going and getting the whether they go to the therapy. So that's the take home message. And thank you. If there's any questions, I'm happy to answer.